Hello and welcome to Med4Care. Today's topic is spinal anesthesia. Let's find out together what it is. Spinal anesthesia consists in blocking the sensitivity of the area affected by surgery, thanks to the injection of local anesthetic near the nerve roots that originate from the spinal cord. Let's see together in more detail what we are talking about. Spinal anesthesia is a technique of neuroaxial anesthesia, in which the anesthetic drug is placed directly in the intrathecal space, or subarachnoid space, of the spine. Under the term neuroaxial anesthesia, reference is made to the placement of local anesthetic in the vicinity of the central nervous system, which includes both the brain and the spinal cord contained in the spine. Cerebrospinal fluid, CSF, is the target of anesthetic injection. In the case of spinal anesthesia, the drug is introduced into the subarachnoid space of the spine that houses the cerebrospinal fluid, CSF. It is a fluid in which the central nervous system, the brain, and the spinal cord are immersed. In an adult human organism, approximately 130 to 140 milliliters of cerebrospinal fluid is present. Every day, about 500 milliliters of cerebrospinal fluid are produced and reabsorbed in a continuous cycle that allows it to be filtered in full about 3 times a day. The anesthetic, once injected, mixes with the cerebrospinal fluid and surrounds the nerve roots, called cauda equina, whose task is to transmit the signal to the lower limbs. How spinal anesthesia works. At the point where the anesthetic is present, incoming pain signals are blocked. In this way, these signals cannot reach the higher centers, especially the brain. Often the quantities of anesthetic used do not block all incoming signals, but only pain signals. For example, sensitivity to touch may be retained. This effect is manifested by anesthetics in general and is not a specific consequence of spinal anesthesia. Spinal anesthesia therefore selectively blocks nerve signals. This happens because the nerve fibers responsible for the transport of signals have different sizes and require different dosages to be blocked in their operation. On the one hand, the nerve fibers that carry the painful signal are smaller and therefore are the ones that are first blocked even with a reduced amount of anesthetic. On the other, this does not happen with those of tactile sensitivity and movement, larger. Indications for spinal anesthesia. Neuroaxial anesthesia is used as the only anesthetic or in combination with general anesthesia, conscious sedation, or with deep sedation. Spinal anesthesia is commonly used for surgery involving the lower abdomen, pelvis, perineum, and lower limbs. The most common spinal anesthesia is spinal anesthesia for cesarean section, spinal anesthesia for lower limb orthopedic surgery, spinal anesthesia for general surgery procedures. It is useful for procedures under the navel because this is the level of anesthesia that can be achieved with high safety. There is, however, the possibility to practice spinal anesthesia even above the lumbar level in very specific and selected situations. Spinal anesthesia is the best choice for short procedures. General anesthesia is usually preferable for larger operations or those that would impair breathing. Spinal anesthesia in association with general anesthesia. Spinal anesthesia in combination with general or deep sedation. Sometimes in some patients, the feeling of not being able to move the legs and feeling paralyzed causes a discomfort. In these cases, it is possible to associate spinal anesthesia to conscious sedation or deep sedation. Advantages of spinal anesthesia. Spinal anesthesia has a number of advantages over conventional general anesthesia. Let's see what they consist of. Among the intraoperative advantages of spinal anesthesia are to avoid the use of intravenous drugs. During surgery, spinal anesthesia eliminates pain in the area downstream of the puncture. Since the pain is completely abolished, it is not necessary to administer additional pain medication during surgery. The amount of intravenous drugs is thus calibrated only in order to obtain a good sedation or relaxation, avoiding in particular the opioid drugs that have different side effects. Subarachnoid anesthesia also prevents tracheal intubation and mechanical ventilation. There are also numerous advantages deriving from this type of anesthesia in the post-operative phase. Among the most important are better post-operative pain control, less stunning, improved efficiency of the patient in post-operative care, reduction of the risk of venous thromboembolism, reduction of the times of the lodging, faster recovery of intestinal functions, increased and improved participation in early post-operative physical therapy. Preparation of spinal anesthesia. Before induction of neuroaxial anesthesia, a complete history and objective examination must be performed. As for the history, it is important to know if the patient has already been subjected to previous anesthesia, if he suffers from allergies, and if in family history there have been problems with anesthetics. Patient advice on the procedure is required and signed informed consent is required. This is because the procedure is usually performed on awake or slightly sedated patients. It is essential to make patients understand that they will have little or no ability to move the lower limbs until the resolution of the block. The physical examination generally focuses on the site of placement of spinal anesthesia. The back should receive a full examination. A check for systemic or local skin infections, spinal abnormalities, pre-procedural neurological examination for strength and sensitivity are also crucial for assessment and documentation. A procedural timeout or checklist for patient safety in the operating room must then be performed, confirming the identity of the patient, the planned procedure, the allergy, the control of consent, and the verbal statement of the state of coagulation. Drugs used for spinal anesthesia. Among the most used drugs in spinal anesthesia we find local anesthetics, such as prilocaine, bupivacaine, and levobupivacaine. Opiates, such as fentanyl, sulfentanil, morphine, ketamine. Adjuvant agents, such as benzodiazepines or clonidine. These drugs can be administered individually or in combination, especially if you want a longer duration of anesthesia. It is a short-acting anesthetic. Due to its characteristics, it is more suitable for very short and not excessively painful operations, where rapid recovery is required, even for a discharge on the same day of surgery. Bupivacaine. It's a medium-long-acting anesthetic. It is generally used in the concentration at 0.5% mg/100 ml and in isobaric or hyperbaric formulations, depending on the need. Levobupivacaine. It is a long-acting anesthetic. It is typically used in the concentration of 0.5% mg/100 ml or 0.75% mg/100 ml. Levobupivacaine has a lower neurological and cardiac toxicity than bupivacaine, so it can be used in higher or higher total concentrations without developing significant side effects. The procedure of subarachnoid anesthesia. First, you need to establish the optimal position of the patient. The procedure is usually performed with the patient in a sitting position or in lateral decubitus position on one side. The choice of location depends on many and several factors. Greater patient comfort, as in the case of forced fractures of the limbs or decubitus. The desired location of the local anesthetic. The goal of positioning is to help establish a straight path for inserting the needle between the vertebrae. The most commonly used position is the sitting position. This is because, in the position of lateral decubitus, the spinal anatomy is usually not symmetrical laterally as in the sitting position. When the patient is in a sitting position, with the leg leaning to the side of the bed, he is encouraged to keep the spine flexed, this to help open the vertebral spaces and allow a more accessible needle transit. The local anesthetic, usually about 2 milliliters 2% of lidocaine, is used for skin infiltration, and a knob is created at the chosen access site, on the midline or paramedic. Median approach for spinal anesthesia. In the median approach, the spinal approach to intrathecal space is the midline with a straight line framing. After infiltration with lidocaine, the doctor introduces the spinal needle into the skin, slightly angled at the mullet. As the needle slides deeper, it will engage the supraspinated ligament and then the interspinal ligament. The doctor will notice it as an increase in tissue strength. Then there will be the ligamentum flavum, and this would present itself as a pop. Passing through this ligament, there is the approach to the epidural space, which is the point of placement of drugs and catheters administered epidurally. For spinal anesthesia, the doctor proceeds with the insertion of the needle until the penetration of the heart subarachnoid membranes, signaled by cerebrospinal fluid. It is at this point that the administration of spinal drugs takes place. Paramedian approach for spinal anesthesia. For the paramedian approach, the cutaneous knob of the local anesthetic is positioned about 2 centimeters from the midline and the spinal needle advances at an angle towards the midline. In this approach, you usually do not encounter suprarenal and interspinal ligaments. Possible complications of spinal anesthesia. Complications related to spinal anesthesia are generally very low. Remember the most common. Headache after puncture / spinal anesthesia. Pain after spinal anesthesia. Nausea or vomiting. Hypotension after spinal anesthesia. The headache that occurs after spinal puncture for anesthesia is relatively frequent but also equally benign. It is usually due to the leakage of the liquor through the hole in the layer called dura mater that is performed to introduce the anesthetic with the needle below the layer, inside the subarachnoid space. This leak is not to be considered a real complication of the procedure, but rather a potential direct consequence of the act. The likelihood of headache after subarachnoid anesthesia is correlated with some factors. Needle size used. Number of attempts and or stings of the dura mater occurred. Female gender. The possibility that pain persists at the point of injection, even days or weeks after the spinal puncture, is directly related to the traumatic damage due to the passage of the needle between the tissues, and is directly proportional to the amount of attempts performed. Nausea or vomiting are usually side effects that typically show up in acute, in correspondence with a rather significant hypotension, or for a slow heart rate, both quite frequent events after a spinal puncture. Finally, hypotension after spinal anesthesia is usually short-lived. It affects the post-operative period, as well as that of the surgery itself, and is directly related to the effect of anesthetic on nerve fibers. In conclusion, neuroaxial anesthesia offers many advantages that are not available with general anesthesia and is therefore a valid alternative to it. The combination of spinal anesthesia with other anesthetic techniques, general anesthesia, conscious sedation and deep sedation, allows a perfect balance between patient comfort and the advantages of the procedure. We are now at the end of today's video. We hope you enjoyed it. If you found it useful, please support us with a nice like and subscribe to the channel. See you soon on Med4Care.